Hello everyone, thank you for listening to the recorded presentation which integrates our PICO in the ERE 6.3 session. I will present the work we have recently conducted between Harriet Watt University, Shell Global Solutions and the University Center in Svalbard. The title of this work is Role of Fault and Fracture Networks to the Risk Geological Leakage from Subsurface Energy Sites. Flow in fractured rock masses with low matrix permeability is ubiquitous in the context of geoenergy applications. Some of the applications include extraction of hot water from geothermal reservoirs, risk assessment of CO2 leakage through fracture cap rocks during CO2 storage operations, and modeling of fluid flow in fractured hydrocarbon reservoirs. In carbon storage operations, fracture might be either present in the storage reservoir, such as naturally fractured reservoirs, or in the cap rock. This last case can present issue as CO2 can flow upwards to the surface. A detailed characterization of fluid flow in fracture network is therefore fundamental for the evaluation of the feasibility of many geoenergy related projects. I will present a procedure developed to establish the stress permeability relationship in a low permeability fractured formation. It is applied to calculate effective permeabilities for a case study in the Cretaceous cap rock in Svalbard. The procedure involves linking experimentally determined fracture aperture and natural fracture network map on the study side with a linear elastic mechanical model to account for the effect of applied stress on fracture aperture and permeability. The rock matrix is considered impermeable in the cap rock so that flow can take place only through the fractures. As described in the outline, I will first describe the fault in the fracture network from the study case. Then I will show you the outputs of the laboratory stress permeability measurement. And finally, I will briefly discuss the hydromechanical model for upscaling effective permeability. Our study site is in the Konuzdalen area. This area is situated on the northeast margin of the central Spitzenberg basin, which was formed following the oblique transpression related to the development of a dextral transform zone between Greenland and Norway. The Konuzdalen area exposed a shale dominant subsection belonging to the Middle Jurassic to Lower Cretaceous and Early Cretaceous. These shale-rich sequences represent the outcrop analog of the regional cap rock in Seal for a target storage formation in the Longyearbyen CO2 laboratory. The studied area exposes a system of mesoscale normal fault characterized by displacement up to a few tens of meters and striking roughly northeast-southeast. Antithetic faults are also present. For this study, we have acquired outcrop data using a drone surveys, applying the structure for motion photogrammetry technique to build up the high-resolution digital surface model and orthomosaic of the area of interest. Photogrammetric dataset were acquired approximately north-south trending in the Konuzdalen Valley section. To record single fracture permeability values, we have updated a custom-designed triaxial permeometer. We conduct a steady-state experiment using nitrogen as permeating fluid. The nitrogen flow rate is then used to calculate sample permeability. We perform tests on a series of low-permeability shales rocks, such as Nash Point sample from the Bristol Channel and the Calmer claystone sample from Utah. And then to the data set, we had the literature data from other low permeability rocks, including shales formation from Svalbard. Laboratory single fracture stress permeability measurements can be used to derive empirical relationships between the applied stress and the fracture aperture. Zhang, 2013, derived a relationship between the gas permeability of the sample, which is here is called kappa core, the permeability of the matrix, which is kappa matrix, and the fracture aperture, here symbolized with B. The model gives a relationship between the applied stress and the total permeability of the sample, which can be used to produce a general relationship for the fracture aperture as function of the applied normal stress. Laboratory experiments can recreate the stress condition in the subsurface, yet these are limited to single fracture permeability. However, fracture rarely occur as single, isolated feature, and more often they form highly complex networks. We can gather information on the property associated with fracture system analyzing fracture and fault networks on outcrops. We use FragPack to obtain fundamental information regarding the attributes, for example, length and orientation, the spatial distribution, such as intensity and density, and the topology, connectivity, of those fractures visible in the virtual outcrop model generated from the outcrop. In the study location, the caprock formation are cut by a low-angle dipping normal fault with minor antithetic splays, as we can see here in this image, but also from the drone image. To map the fault in the fracture network, we selected two areas of the orthomosaic reconstruction which are less affected by debris cover. For brevity today, I will show you data from the lower portion of the outcrop section here, which we can name Area 1. Area 1 includes the bottom part of the main fault and at least two minor splays oriented about 60 degrees clockwise from the main fault. In this area, we identified a total of visible fracture with a number of 505 fractures, with an average fracture length of about 5 meters. Minimum fracture length was detected of about 0.05 meters, while maximum length recorded is 73 meters and corresponds to the trace of the main fault. It must be noted that this last measure, however, suffered of truncation bias as the trace of the main fault continue beyond the limits of the area 1 we have selected here. Nevertheless, owing to the high resolution of the drone images, data for fracture length spans over 3 orders of magnitude from tens of meters to few centimeters, thus allowing us for a robust statistical analysis of this attribute. For this data set, we found out that a log normal distribution is the most probable statistics underlying the data. For both the color-coded map of fracture orientation and its corresponding rose diagram that we can see in figure A, we can distinguish the northeast-southwest trending normal fault and its associated conjugate set of secondary faults and fracture which strikes northwest-southeast. This map and diagram also show the presence of a vertical, in this case eastward striking set of fracture, that is likely to have postponed the faulting event, and it cuts through the fault-related fractures. This vertical set of fracture appears predominantly distributed in the top and right side of the fracture trace map, and appear that fracture traces here are bounded within the limits of a specific rock layers. The density map, we can see cluster of fractures in the vicinity of the main fault trace and near one of the major conjugate faults. Conjugate secondary faults. We have selected sub-areas, here we call window, within the whole caprock section to later be used as input for the stress permeability numerical modeling. Using the totality of fracture network as identified from the virtual outcrop would have been computationally prohibitive unless to model a simplified version of the fracture network. We wanted to model a real fracture network, thus we decided to choose a smaller area to then be modeled. The selected windows has an area of approximately 15 meters by 30 meters for height and width, and fall in the vicinity of what it can be of the damage zone of the main fault. For this sub-area, we concentrate our analysis on the topological arrangement of fracture network. In other words, on the connectivity within the network, as this information can be directly used to produce analytical estimation of fracture network permeability, which we will then compare with the simulated permeability using a modeling. Window 1 has a total of 147 fracture traces with a minimum trace length of 1 cm and a maximum trace length of 11 meters and an average fracture trace of about 0.5 meters. FRACPAC has estimated that the connectivity of the network is ensured through a combination of Y, X and I nodes. Through a combination of Y and X nodes predominantly. Where the high nodes correspond to isolated endpoints and fracture traces, the Y nodes correspond to splay or abutments, and the X nodes correspond to cross-cutting connection. Using the Suzuki method, FRACPAC has estimated a permeability tensor in the direction of the flow with a principal permeability of about 7.6 to the minus 18 meter square. Using the second method called Sevick-Nixon method, which uses only the topological information, basically only a ratio of connectivity, we instead estimate an effective permeability of a bulk effective permeability of about 2 to the minus 19 meter square. The modeling uses laboratory single fracture stress permeability relationship obtained through fracture core flood experiment and the real 2D field of fracture networks as mapped from the study area. The fracture network is meshed using a freely available software called PoroPy. The meshes are then loaded and further processed using an implemented workflow in an open source SINTEF MRST MATLAB reservoir simulation toolbox. The workflow for upscaling the fracture network permeability is described here in this workflow. So the contact pressures at each node of the digitized fractures are computed using a finite element solver for a set of stress boundary conditions. We calculate a fracture network aperture field combining the contact pressure value with the laboratory stress permeability data. The corresponding permeability field is obtained assuming a parallel plate law in the fractures. Finally, using single phase upscaling and Darcy law, we determine the effective upscale permeability for the fracture networks. Repeating the workflow for varying set of stress boundary conditions provides a stress-sensitive fracture network permeability that can be used as a proxy for permeability at a reservoir scale. The pressure profile that we show here in the first image shows a single phase fluid flow pressure distribution for each fracture in the analyzed network. In this simulation, we have set both horizontal and vertical stress at 4 MPa. From the stress permeability surface plot, we can derive that at 4 MPa, we can expect a bulk permeability in the fracture network of about 1 to the minus 17, between 1 to the minus 17 and 1 to the minus 16 meters squared. These values are close to the permeability values that we estimated using purely geometrical methods as shown before. The results of the stress permeability plot show that upscale fracture network permeability ranges over 5 orders of magnitude under different stress conditions. The permeability is decreasing faster with the increase of horizontal stress compared to smallest drop when the vertical stress is varied. The reason for this mainly lays in the fracture network geometry along the fracture, which extend mostly onto the Y direction, meaning they will experience more normal stress induced from horizontal stress than from the vertical. To summarize, we built a workflow that integrates laboratory single fracture permeability measurements, acquisition and analysis of large-scale natural fracture and fault network from caprock analog, with numerical simulation for effective permeability for these fracture patterns under stresses. This enables us to establish a stress permeability relationship that can serve as a proxy model for large-scale simulation and formation characterization for geological CO2 storage. Thank you very much for listening.